Little less constrained for time. We have one of the papers that will be presented on Skype, so Tokyo Institute of Technology. Dhrubo, as we discussed earlier, if we can think about 15 minutes for the paper, and then we will do a quick round of Q&A. Are you able to hear us? Can you?
Yes.
Okay, great. So Dhrubo will be changing, I think, the PPTs from your side itself. So whenever you're ready, Dhrubo, we can start with your paper.
Yes, I'd like to start now. Good morning, everyone.
Sorry, Dhrubo, I'm just interrupting for 1 second. This whole session is being live streamed. So just wanted to let you know as well regarding that. Yeah, Dhrubo, go ahead, please.
Good morning, everyone, and this is Dhrubo from Dhaka. And first of all, I would just like to thank everyone for making this opportunity to present from here. Our paper is named Early Transportation System of Dhaka and its Evolution. We have tried to describe Dhaka's history very briefly, but mostly focusing on the transportation. And as we all know, Dhaka is the capital of Bangladesh. It's one of the mostly populated cities, if not the most populated, most densely populated city in the world.
Dhrubo, yeah. I'm sorry, I'm interrupting again. We have a blank screen on our side. We're not able to see the slides. Is that you'll have to change it, I think, switch on your screen from your side for some.
Is it working now?
No, it is still a blank screen. Okay. Yeah, no, not that one. Is your screen shared, Dhrubo?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, we are only seeing a blank screen, so can we just give you a call back?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, and again, change of plans. Let's, so, I mean, we'll try and keep trying and get Dhrubo back. But I think it makes sense. Maybe if we can start with Tahera's paper, and we'll bring back Dhrubo as the connection goes through. Tahera is joining us from the Bangladesh University of Engineering and Technology. And this is also a co-authored paper. Apurba Poddar could not join us today, but is the second author on this paper. He's from the university. You are the second author. Okay, so from the University of Cambridge, right? And their paper is called Understanding Rurality in the Age of Technology Through a Lens of Constraints, a Case of Water Bodies in Khulna in Bangladesh. Yeah, so.
I am Tabassum. I am an architect researcher. I practice architecture back in Bangladesh. We also established a non-profit. It's a research and development organization. The major mission of our organization is empowerment through place. So this paper is a part of that journey. The title of our paper is Understanding Rurality Through a Lens of Constraint. 45.7% of people in Bangladesh are living in urban areas, and which continues to increase 1.69% per year by rapidly transforming rural areas to meet the demand of urbanization. However, the World Bank suggests that the rate of urbanization is not enough, as it falls behind East Asia. Alike to the World Bank, there is also debate going on among the government, scholars, and investors to bring all rural areas in Bangladesh under compact township or turn all villages into towns. Already, a number of scholarly concerns have questioned the mode of urbanization. A recent article published by Dr. Khaled Ashraf criticized current urban development approach to be a dry core planning. He explained that due to the emphasis of physical infrastructure, the waterscape of Bengal is ignored. His article renews the concern how badly urbanized landscape has ignored the key component of deltaic landscape. The deltaic landscape of Bengal evolved in negotiating with the water. Water remained and used to be the core component in the traditional so-called rural landscape. The organization of economic and social models are integrated with water. Our concern and reservation against current mode of urbanization and technological development stem from there. We reviewed the transformation from rural to urban in one of the most important regions of Bangladesh, Khulna, to evaluate the trajectory of urbanization before erasing the rurality by the urban landscape. As a city, Khulna occupied the third most important position in the country. Khulna holds a colonial history more than 100 years. However, going through the urban history of Khulna, a brief concern about rurality. This is the map of showing urban growth of Khulna. In literature, rurality carries a wide range of definition. In a significant volume of academic writings, rurality is defined by underdevelopment and with a negative dimension of slowness. A majority literatures are progress-centric and where physical aspect of rurality represent as the problematic aspect of rural areas. This situation is viewed more than a challenge of living rather than a positive condition of choice in the development process. Despite these negative dimensions, there are now growing literatures reveals many important aspects of rural realities, without which this dimension of rurality fails to capture comprehensive rural realities. Dr. Chigbu explored rurality with a lens of ecological and social relationship. He talked about people-to-people, people-to-place relationship, which gives an overview of socially rich landscape. We examine the mostly criticized aspect of rurality, physical constraint. We argue that constraint is both a core component and a strength of rurality. Coming to the urban history of Khulna. In 1781, as a magistrate, Mr. Henken arrived Jossor, and just after his posting, he realized that the forest land of region has a huge source of revenue. He proposed the government to reclaim the forest land to Sundarbans and lease those to local landlords for cultivation. Between 1790 and 1846 of the colonial government overlooked extensive mapping to lease the forest land to local landlord for cultivation. This instigates a long history of legal boundary on forest land and transforming its element into landed property. A new vocabulary of landscape had been practiced where land became the key determining force in the transforming. Eventually, to remove the constraint of transporting agriculture produce and make the good of transport, transport faster, the colonial government established the railway and the road network. These remove the constraint but initiate a new mode of development. The previous circulation route that meshed with the intricate relationship between water and land provided constraint to move the goods, but at the same time, foster new opportunities for livelihood and socialization. The relationship between people to place and people to people in the rural landscape, which were created through the constraint of transport, has been replaced by the speed of technology and advanced infrastructure. Landscape appears in affected by the bold lines of roads. These roads also cement the age of landscape, eliminating including water bodies and canals, making those ecologically handicapped urban objects. In 1961, Master Plan of Khulna shows that the previous landscape lines were straining to create a efficiency in the circulation, making the circulation to ignore the lines of the landscape. In successive decades, with the growth of urban Khulna and the technological achievement, the mesh was broken into a hierarchy of planning. Everything became constructed and the part which were marked as unplanned, the constant urge construct image of development and remove constraint, internalized the landscape and made the inhabitants, neighborhoods, also like isolated bubble of a soap. To take example of water, before 60s, one of the center neighborhood in the city used to depend on the pond called named Tarer Pukur. The red one is for drinking water. As much as the neighborhood was named after the pond, the everyday act of bringing water from Tarer Pukur made the place to platform, creating a mesh indicate social special relationship. However, in the late 60s, after establishment of government water agency, it is modernized water pipe system and the constraint to bring water from the pond has been removed. With the infrastructure development, provision of water supply at home and the neighborhood no longer needed to come to the pond to collect water, the dependency on that pond ended. With no dependency on the pond, the government struggled to maintain the pond for a few years. That objective could not achieve for long. The water body later after filled with landed to create a more landed property. To conclude, I want to discuss a few things about rurality and constraint. People and their surroundings are both product and process of several parallel histories. These histories are interconnected with each other, different layers. Each layer of those historians has different dimension: time, political, economical, social and spatial dimension. We tend to evaluate everything which is visible or most popular layer without being critical with the inner or invisible layer, which created the huge gap with reality and narration. In the history of Khulna, we see that the power play treated landscape as an instrument of the financial return, rather than other member of the story, which have their own versatile character and contribution. In reality, the landscape and its constraint in rurality is a co-living entity, which had been separate for higher economic return and development. This type of segregation create huge distance between people to people, people to place. Talking about rurality, commonly two concepts are overwhelming. First one is very utopian view, consisting of fresh air, fresh food, and all good soul people. And the second one is the story of underdevelopment. Rurality is a major victim of those two persisting historical concerns. History, because of those two given biased and our fabricated top-viewed reality of rurality, is presented in front of us. Isolated thought in either of the two esteem lacks the gist of relationship that reality can create. Definition stems from history, which is a collection of few relationship with respect to time. However, like the functioning of ecology, the constraint of reality forced people to build a changing relationship with landscape. We focus on our needs of the people and separate them by the developing of infrastructure. We remove relationship they have. For example, the water body of Tarid Pukur neighborhood, where people needed to come to the pond and water and for water, embracing the constraint, a scenery is very common in rural areas. Providing supply water was a highly demanding and practical development strategy. However, ignored the relationship they have through the persistence of constraint. With the agency remove the name of development. The relationship between water and neighborhood, written by the everyday inconvenience of bringing water home, was written in a negative manner in the lens of development. In our foam bubble, like isolated living beings see this relationship as constraint, where place to place, people to people, place to people, relationships are still present and practiced through constraint. We have considered them as rural and underdevelopment. This paper argues that it is necessary to think beyond the linear history of the name of development, ignoring the fact the mutual dependence is the ecosystem. We tend to remove the constraint and dependency, thereby directly interrupt the ecosystem, which result nothing good but to create a non-relational cosmic urban development. Yes.
So we're going to hold the questions till the end of the session, if that is okay. Unless someone has some kind of a very burning question they want to ask immediately. Yeah? Okay. So, can I request you to go next, sure, and we'll bring in Dhrubo in the end.
Can I just have this light dimmed a bit, please, because I'm probably have this dark background.
Because it's going to be live streamed.
Okay. Good morning. I'm Salila Vanka. I teach at RV College of Architecture, Bangalore. And the theme of today's this conference in general, city and technology, is one that's really been of interest to me for a very long time now. And appropriate technology, basically, in the application of appropriate technology in building livable communities. So I'm very happy to be here this morning with this opportunity to present my thoughts on this subject in my paper titled Appropriate Technology for People-Centric cities, learning from the works of Patrick Geddes and Laurie Baker in India. So, as city governments continue their outward gaze, seeking new technological fixes for managing Indian cities, this paper is a call, and it kind of calls for a renewed engagement with the concept of appropriate technology, which has been on the horizon of technological choices for nearly 50 years now. And the idea being appropriate technology is perhaps an integral part of the cities, should be an integral part of the city's planning toolkit, thinking of cities for people that are built by people and with people in mind. So the field itself, which I shall talk about later in greater detail, is very vast and broad in scope and breadth. So my intent in this particular paper is, as I said, my interest is in the built environment, coming from the disciplines of architecture and urban planning, and my intent is to explore the works of Patrick Geddes and Laurie Baker, two Westerners that made India their home, one temporarily and one permanently. And in through their own work, they kind of brought out what they would not term appropriate technology in, or solutions, appropriate technological solutions for their for the Indian context, but it kind of, their work reflected the principles of appropriate technology to my mind, human scale, using technology that is accessible to local workmen, and also economic considerations like cost efficiency. So I'm going to start off with a brief introduction of the topic, the subject or the concept of appropriate technology itself. Then I talk about Patrick Geddes and his idea of conservative surgery as a way of planning Indian cities in particular. And then I go on to discuss the works of Laurie Baker and his cost-effective architecture. And then I wrap up my presentation with a few propositions which kind of support my central argument that Indian cities, contemporary Indian cities too, should very actively, city governments in particular and communities should very actively engage with this idea of appropriate technology and integrate it in their toolkit in thinking of building livable communities. So technology, the Greek word, it's a combination of techne and logos. So techne, which denotes art, craft, skill or practical knowledge. And this was used by the pre-Socratics to denote a process rather than a set of objects. So that becomes very important. It's a process. And in such a way as to emphasize the unity of action and knowledge. So knowledge should inform action and vice versa. The other main etymological root of technology is the Greek word logos, which denotes the ideas of word, reason, or principle. So the modern usage of the term normally also embraces some reference to social or cultural institutions. So technology is not merely a matter of physical and social hardware, but a force which permeates our political, economic, and social systems. A little more on technology. There's a tendency to rationalize technology as to be something very objective and something that can be used neutrally across disciplines and fields, not generally taking into consideration the politics and the socio-economic consideration, conditions prevailing in that context. So it is frequently reified in popular rhetoric and has come to be viewed as a system or a form of rationality rather than just a collection of artifacts. And the emerging field of social studies in science and technology has provided overwhelming evidence that technology is not neutral, that it does exert a significant determining influence in society, while at the same time reflecting social interests. And that choice from amongst technological alternatives is necessary because those choices kind of define us for who we are too. So some of the possible, some of the characteristics of technology when you consider it as a non-neutral set of artifacts is a savior or a destroyer. It could do either. It could be inappropriate because, not because it's bad, but because it could be out of context. It could be harmful to one section of society, though beneficial to another, and it could be inappropriate for the purposes that it is defined. or its design. So these are some illustrations of that kind of talk, hopefully address those points. Coming to the topic or the theme or the concept of appropriate technology itself, I'd like to talk a little about the originator of the concept, E.F. Schumacher. And he, in his book, Small is Beautiful, Economics as if People Mattered, he wrote this book in 1973. But the idea itself was kind of came into being, or he was thinking about this idea many years before that. So he was an economic advisor for the British government and worked for several years in high positions with the British government. And he was invited to several countries in the global south. He visited Burma, he went to India, he's been to other countries too as an economic advisor. And he was surprised, or he was kind of taken aback to see the difference in how economic development might be in, or be might work better for countries like India, or because the social conditions are different. So he felt that the rational planning model or the economic model that worked in Britain might not be the best for the Indian condition or Burma too. So as early as 1955, when he went to Burma, he found that there's a lot of labor. The factors of production themselves are very different, and there are a lot more rural communities there than you would see in the global north by that time itself. So, and he felt that those were not being taken into consideration when economic development planning was being done. So he says, the system of production by the masses mobilizes the priceless resources which are possessed by all human beings, their clever brains and skillful hands, and supports them with first-class tools. The technology of mass production is inherently violent, ecologically damaging, self-defeating in terms of non-renewable resources, and stultifying for the human person. The technology of production by the masses, making use of the best of modern knowledge and experience, is conducive to decentralization, compatible with the laws of ecology, gentle in its use of scarce resources, and designed to serve the human person instead of making him the servant of machines. I have named it intermediate technology. So the predecessor to appropriate technology was the term intermediate technology, and this is how he defines it. And he says, intermediate technology signifies that it's a vastly superior technology to the primitive technology of bygone ages. So he's not asking us to go back or regress or go back to before the wheel was invented or reinvent the wheel itself, but he says it's much more sophisticated than that, but at the same time much simpler, cheaper and freer than the super technology of the rich, which is the other extreme of the spectrum. Think large infrastructure projects that might be ecologically damaging and disruptive to communities and displacing them and so on. One can also call it self-help technology or democratic or people's technology, a technology to which everybody can gain admittance and which is not reserved those already rich and powerful. So, a definition for appropriate technology is in order. A mode of technology practice aimed at ensuring that technology is compatible with its psychosocial and biophysical context. So the context becomes extremely important. The term may also be used to denote the general concept, social movement or innovation strategy associated with this mode of technology practice. So appropriate technology is not just a technology, it's a technology practice. So we're not just talking about knowledge here, we're talking about application to an action, which is extremely important, because when we have these big terms like sustainable development or appropriate technology itself, they can be very obfuscating and people can interpret it any which way that they want. So it becomes important to kind of understand what applications might occur to and what might work for some societies versus others. Other names, synonyms for appropriate technology over time have been alternative technology, appropriable technology, community technology, convivial tools, eco-technology, humanized technology, intermediate technology, of course, liberatory technology, light capital technology, modest technology, participatory technology, progressive technology, radical technology, soft technology, technology with a human face, utopian technology, vernacular technology, or village level technology. So I think that's one thing, proponents of the appropriate movement that are kind of defending, critics that say that it is dead and over, they say no, it's just taken different forms and it just gets named differently in different societies, in different contexts. So some applications in the global north, I will just skim through these, get to the meat of the presentation. So in the north, it's humanized technology, environmentalism, radical technology, energy pathways, responses to local poverty and unemployment, and so on. So there's a greater emphasis on technological systems that make better living conditions overall. In the global south, it has been a little different, and there's been a lot of literature which has been the boon and bane of appropriate technology too, if you think about it. Whenever you think about it, I've speaking to a few architect colleagues of mine, and they're like, oh, there's this stigma attached to appropriate technology where people think it's for the poor, it's for the masses, and it's not really something that a well-off person would actually want to use, unless it's like a second home or a third home that they're building, and it's just kind of cool to have a brick or a mud block house or whatever. So there's this, or riding a bus, for instance, if you want to call it appropriate for an overcrowded city with very, very small roads and narrow lanes, it still might not have the wide appeal because people don't really think it's cool to ride buses, right? It's cooler to drive a car and sit in traffic for an hour. So some of the applications in the global south, small scale industries, basic needs, village technology, international equity and intranational equity among states too, and and it's supposed to be emancipatory too at some level, because you're talking about self-reliance and self-help at a village level perhaps, and people are using the skills that they already possess rather than having to learn new skill sets to kind of support themselves. This brings us to the first of the two people that I'm going to be talking about today, Sir Patrick Geddes. He's a Scottish biologist, sociologist, geographer, philanthropist, social reformer and town planner, you name it and he's done it. And he's made very strong, very, very big contributions to the field of urban planning. So people, students of urban studies would, and geography too, would be very familiar with his name for sure. So he's introduced terms of region and conurbation, which is like an agglomeration of cities and the region around, to the field of urban planning. He discusses the place, work, folk triad as the defining units of society, and conservative surgery, which is what I'll focus on today, is his notion of how Indian cities or any city that is facing blighted neighborhoods should be kind of planned. And he also, a very key component or very key contribution that Geddes has made to the field of sociology, any social science per se, is the idea of the civic survey, which he says you should thoroughly survey the area that you're going to be actually proposing. It seems like a non-intuitive thing today, which is something we do. We just go and survey and we interview people and learn about the area. But when he suggested it, it was a revolutionary idea to go and examine the geology, geography, climate, economic life, and the social institutions of the city and region and planning. So Geddes was invited to India in he came in 1915, and the governor of Madras actually invited him over, and he wanted him, Geddes, who had already done significant work in Edinburgh and England on planning matters, to come and give his expert advice on how planning should be tackled or how Indian cities should be planned. So he says, he came and he noticed that there was the standard, the Eurocentric planning model, where you have streets going through neighborhoods. Just if there's no room, make room for roads by just raising neighborhoods and going straight through. So he felt perhaps that's not the best way to deal with urban management here. He says, town planning is not mere place planning, nor even work planning. If it is to be successful, it must be folk planning. This means that its task is not to coerce people into new places against their associations, wishes and interests, as we find bad schemes trying to do. Instead, its task is to find the right places for each sort of people, place where they will really flourish, to give people, in fact, the same care that we give when transplanting flowers. Instead of harsh evictions and arbitrary instructions to move on, delivered in the manner of an officious policeman. To me, these words seem refreshingly timeless in the sense, I mean, you do hear of evictions even today. I mean, they happen all the time in the wake of development. And while I won't compare human beings to flowers and plants, there is some truth to the matter that people live, So people do tend to grow roots where they live in the social economic, systems that they thrive in, and then they kind of, it's hard to displace them after some generations. So these are some examples of conservative sense. So Geddes is, what's unique about Geddes is he's celebrated and studied and cited widely in literature and in classrooms, but there's been little application of his work on the ground. And that is probably a topic of discussion for another day, but he had his idea was you see, so this was in Tanjore, and he has, where you see those dark areas in the second drawing B, he felt that, so those were blighted buildings that were falling apart, so his solution was, rather than just tearing down the whole neighborhood, you just clear up those spaces as you see in plan and C, and where you see the dots, those are supposed to be trees. And you kind of create those clearings and make them open spaces, community spaces for people to use. So I will just skip this. I'll just quickly talk about what he means by conservative surgery. So it's not just about creating economically planning spaces. It's, economy is not just of removing less buildings, but it's also of money. So he says, by conservative surgery for this particular project, the total expense would have been for the planner, the official planner would have been 30,000 rupees, but in his from his proposals, it would just be 5,000 rupees. So one can make the same 30,000 rupees go a long way, maybe six neighborhoods could be improved in the same manner. And this is another case in Madura where the first diagram shows the straight lines that the engineer planner drew to clear that space and make a straight road. So Geddes in the option to the right just creates an open space in the middle and also creates access by just removing a couple of structures. So it's not like there's entirely no demolition, but it's kind of thoughtful and just as limited to what's the bare necessity. So one more interesting thing about Geddes is his idea of people's participation, and I thought that is interesting and important, very central to my presentation today. He talks about there being a great need of public cooperation, of an ever-increasing body of active citizens who will no longer leave matters, all matters to official authority, but work with the municipal representatives. A body of citizens who will be both desirous and acceptant of expert leadership, not querulous and murmuring, but yet giving voice to the reasonable remonstrance if need be, since even the best administrations require at times to be reminded that they're not infallible. So that brings us to the second person I'm talking about today. It's Lawrence Wilfrid Baker. He's an English-born architect, and he moved to India in 1945 and worked in the Himalayas, in Himachal Pradesh more specifically, and Kerala from the 1960s. And Baker was very influenced by Mahatma Gandhi, and incidentally, all these individuals, Schumacher, Geddes, and Baker have had conversations with Mahatma Gandhi, and Baker and Schumacher very particularly actually were greatly influenced by his philosophy of rural development and local technology and local skill development, etc. So these are some of his design principles. He talks about, so as you can see, I'll just show you some examples. This is all the writings he's done, some of his publications, and this is his own house, the hamlet in Kerala, and he uses some of his unique design principles are of building with the site, on the site, without disrupting too much and using the natural resource as much as possible. This is the Center for Development Studies. So again, the brick is the his vocabulary develops around the brick, and he uses the brick in many innovative ways to convey different designs. And this is finally a slum development project that Baker designed in Kerala. And if you see to the left the illustration, to the top left you see the typical slum the plan of a typical slum with all the little units, but he kind of says, why don't we just, without making high rise, just at least create 2-3 levels and open up some space for other community activities. So quickly, his design principles, he says every building should be unique. After all, no two persons or families or conditions are alike. He says study or no local materials. And then he also talks about cost efficiency and using, he says, keep your knowledge up to date, but make sure the latest fashions are better than established ways of, before changing. So, and the role of the client also becomes very important. Baker kind of says, I've never doubted that in a country like ours, any of us have any right to squander or waste or use unnecessarily money, materials or energy. And I have never had any personal doubts about who my real clients are. They've never been people with names or personalities. So he's always been talking about affordable housing for the masses. So quickly kind of bringing all these people together in the same space, literally. Gandhi, with his emphasis on rural development and saying that's where India lives. And yeah. And then you have Schumacher and Patrick Geddes and Lawrence Baker talking about responsible and responsive technology, use of local factors of production, local job skills and jobs and skills, economic development, people-centric planning and nature-friendly planning and self-reliance. With this background, my question was, what is the role of appropriate technology in strengthening people's participation in shaping the built environment in contemporary Indian cities? So just thinking about maybe some examples that are happening today. You have some very positive developments, like we had a seminar in our college a couple of months back, and Vishwanath, who's the rainwater harvesting expert in Bangalore, he talked about how Belgaum, the government in Belgaum, is actually reinvigorating their abandoned wells and that already exist. So, and then there's rainwater harvesting. So policy also could do it. Rainwater harvesting is mandatory in Bangalore now. Then there's this story on new 150 electric buses soon plying in Bangalore's roads. And of course, mud blocks are used very regularly in architecture. So I just conclude with a few propositions conclude my paper with a few propositions. This paper calls for integration of appropriate technology in planning decisions, not just in rural areas. It's been a very rural thing so long, and very small scale in cities. So I feel it should be moved to cities too. And abandon the either or approach in adopting technology for cities. Rather, it should be a scaled approach. The inquiry there being, what technology is appropriate at what scale? There's a need to integrate appropriate technology wherever possible as a viable choice. For this to happen, it is important to mainstream appropriate tech practices through policy too. Government plays an important role to make it more acceptable and accessible to more people. And in a milieu of rapid urbanization in Indian cities that are not only hotbeds of socioeconomic inequalities, I also feel they're fertile areas for innovative and creative thinking, as we saw from the previous slide. So there's a lot of scope for that to happen today. And so appropriate technology can become an effective tool in enhancing participatory planning in ways that involve communities in creative and productive manner. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Salila. So I think we are going to move to the last paper, Dhrubo. If you're with us, can you hear us? Oh. Okay, so while we kind of bring him back online, are there any questions that people would sort of like to ask for the first two sets of paper that we have heard?
Hello, I am Sushant from DIIHS Hyderabad. So I had one question while you were elaborating on Geddes' idea of planning Indian cities. You said that it should not be Eurocentric and it should be more of a folk planning. So while you were describing the idea of folk planning, it was like you should go wishes of the people, like how they want to stay in communities or how they want to, I mean, plan their own space. So I was thinking this in the backdrop of, say, ghettoization. Like, so how would you compare these two ideas? Like, folk planning, wouldn't it lead to more ghettoization? Like, say white people living in one place, black in one place, or say lower caste people, Muslim communities, and say other communities living in one space. So, and if you could like join, say how technology, appropriate technology could help in not ghettoizing these.
That's a very good question, and it's something that has been written about quite recently. Karthik Rao Kavale, he's a PhD student in Michigan, not Michigan, MIT, and he talks about, and it's because there is that concern when you, first of all, when Geddes was talking about folk, he didn't literally mean people, folk as in people living in their little things, but he was making the connection between place and work and society, people in the cities. So he was trying to say they're all interlinked, and hence they should be considered together, you know, rather than just thinking of a residence separate from where the person works. So they're all interlinked, so that's the idea of the folk. But there has been, Geddes is not all that forthcoming with what he means by citizens. He uses the word citizens in his writings, and that's one question that came to my mind too, as we know that it's not as innocent as everyone in the city when you talk about a citizen, which is why Lefebvre uses the idea of the city inhabitant, and he doesn't say citizen, because you know, someone that's residing in the city, because people make claims to the city saying I pay taxes and rent, and so I'm like a legal legitimate citizen versus the ones that don't. So it is problematic, and yeah, this Geddes is not overly forthcoming, and what you, the concern that you pointed about ghettoization happening, yes, if people are allowed, I mean, if planning is done in a such a manner that people are just, you have neighborhoods just designed for the people that live there, there is that danger of kind of secluding them to those sectors. But I guess when you talk about technology, then if you think about appropriate technology and whether there's a way to kind of reduce the evils of ghettoization, maybe access through the city itself, access within the city and around the city, maybe would be one way. Making it, if I think about a situation where a person doesn't have public transit, a person that's not able to afford to go to another part of the town for, because they don't have options. I'm just thinking of transportation, that's a simple example, I guess. But then if you have bus facilities perhaps, or if you somehow make jobs more available in local areas rather than just moving all the jobs outside the city. So maybe skill development and kind of creating, that's one pet project that architecture students have, doing workshops in every design, urban design project, that they have this workshops that kind of aims at, my colleague Anuradha is smiling. But so, it's trying to kind of localize and enhance local skills so people do not have to move around.
When Bangalore Development Authority was allotting sites in Bangalore, they would actually ask for your, this is a rumor that I've heard of, you would actually get a Muslim on the same street, a Brahmin on the same street. So that is the way they were looking at putting people together in the older parts. I'm talking about Jayanagar specifically. Whereas if you look at Basungudi, whatever she's talking about, the ghettoization is very, very clearly demarcated in the plan, because there is Wakaliga in one place, Brahmins in one place, Chetiyas in the other place, that Krishna Rao Park and the diagonals. It's very, very clearly indicated over there. Okay? So, it's a debate. It's an ongoing debate with no conclusion yet.
So I think we should hopefully continue that conversation. It's a very interesting thread to take forward. But in the constraint of time, since Dhrubo is back online, I think let's try and have his presentation first, and then with the time remaining, we can go on to the questions again. So Dhrubo, can you hear us?
Yes.
Okay, so if you can share your, yeah, we can see your screen. I think we can start. We're running short on time now, so I'm going to hold you to the 15 minute quite rigorously, I'm afraid. So I will just give you the when 5 minutes are left, 2 minutes are left, or when the time is up, okay? Just so that we have some time left over for conversation. If I can ask you to finish within the 15 minute frame. Okay?
Can you check the changes in the slides?
Do you want us to do the change? Yeah, we can see the changes in the slides.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm checking that it's working or not.
Yeah, it's working good. Thank you.
Hello again, and good morning, everyone. I'm Dhrubo from Dhaka, Bangladesh, and I'm thanking everyone and sorry for the inconvenience. I'm going to present the paper we have produced on early transportation system of Dhaka and its evolution. We have tried to explain very briefly Dhaka's history and mostly focused on the transportation system. Dhaka, as we know, is the capital of Bangladesh, and it's one of the most densely populated cities in the world. It has around 15 million people living in only 325 square kilometers area. It's supposedly it's 400 years old city, established by the Mughals, Islam Khan. But as we will see from the next few slides, that it's even older. From various maps and documents, we have found the name Dhaka even in the 1500s. The city is on the bank of the river Buriganga, and it started exactly along the river because of the natural levee, which has a higher elevation, so it doesn't get waterlogged or get affected by flooding. So the city was expanding in a north-south direction, which was a bit unusual to see on the map. As we can see, the location of Dhaka is almost now at the center of the Bangladesh, and the nearest mega city here is Kolkata. As we say. This on the left side, we can see the map made by the Portuguese João de Barros in 1550, where there is a name Dhaka that we have found. And so actually before 1610, there was traces of Dhaka and settlements all around, as we know. And this is the present, on the right map, this is the present Dhaka boundary, and this is the geomorphology of Dhaka, and it's in the Mughal period, the city was bounded within this yellow circle, it grew along the natural levee, which is a bit brownish, so the city was very linear, and this is the first British map of Dhaka made by James Grinnell in 1780, and Dhaka was shrinking then. There was a power shift between from the Mughals to the British, and we will see that there are two canals quite large. This one is Dhulai, and there is another one which is called Pandu. Both of them are lost now, but these two provided very good transportation connection inside Dhaka and also connecting the other settlements. And as Dhaka was shrinking, we can see very smaller settlements up north and along the river, which got detached and was connected with these small canal streams and few roads. There were very, very few roads, and most of them were not metalled. And this is the next map we could found from this was also made by the British administration And this is actually Dhaka at it with its smallest border. Still there is lots of water, and most of the area has become marshland and waterlogged. There is a race course on the north of the city and few churches, but other than that, the city is mostly, I would say, full of water bodies. The next map is from 1924. From the 20th century, the city started to grow again, mainly because of the British administration. It has expanded the city, created some new infrastructure and buildings, and one of the main infrastructure we could see is the railway. There used to be the Dhaka old railway station, and this is the new railway line. So the other side of the river, the northern side of the railway, was called the new city, the new part of the city, and the older part was the south, along the bank of Buyonga. The very early transportation system was mostly riverine, and boat was the main mode of transport, and two main connections in the city was Dholai and Pandu River, or sometimes it's called canals. It has become canals from a river with time, and it was slow and unreliable, but most of the passengers and goods in the rainy season used boat. In the dry season, they would have walked or used ox carriages. Also, for the riches, there are elephants. These photos are these pictures are drawn by Charles Doyle, who was here in Dhaka in the early 19th century. These are the earliest proofs we could find from the photos or the pictures. We can see one palanquin, elephants, and actually people walking to the roads. And this is the views from the mainly dry season, so when there is no water. Now I would just move to the main travel modes, which have came. Mostly they came with the Europeans. The first one was the horse carriages. This was brought by the Armenians in 1856 for public. This was the first public transport. These are the hackney carriages, and this is probably one of the very few pictures drawn by Charles Doyle. Again, Charles Doyle, he was the company painter who drawn the hackney carriage, and it came to this was not that hackney, this was the Lando carriage, which came with the British officers. This was the only four-wheel transport available in Dhaka before 1856. So it came with the British, and the Nawab of Dhaka bought it, and it survived, as we know from the documents, till 1824. And after that, the Armenians, for the public transport, brought the hackney carriages. In 1867, the number was 60, and in 1889, it grew tenfold to 600. It was hugely popular. The main mode of transport became walking, and then the hackney carriages. Another public transport came is the railway. This was the railway station on the photo on the top. It was established in Fulbaria, as shown in the map. And this is one of one of the first photos of the rails carriages which have arrived in Dhaka in the 1890s. The train came to Dhaka in 1885. Actually, it connected Narayanganj a port and another very profitable jute producing area, Mamunchin, further up north from Dhaka. So the main motive for the rail track establishment was business, and to export the jute from Mamunchin to Dhaka, then to Narayanganj, and then to finally to Calcutta. the raw dream.
Dhrubo, just a quick, I'm sorry, but about another 5 minutes. I'm sorry to interrupt in the middle, but about 5 minutes.
So, the rail track used to be in the center of the city, the orangish one. It got changed in the 1960s. It moved further up north and towards east. The current red line is the current rail track. The orange one was the previous one, and it had two rail stations, which has been abandoned now. The rickshaws came in the 30s. It's very difficult to find very rickshaws on the left side. We could find some photos in Singapore. These used to run in Dhaka in 1930s, but what we have found in the 1950s, there are rickshaw. The photos on the right is from the 1950s in Dhaka, and the rickshaws came in the 1937. In 1938, there are many stories involving that how it came, who brought it. But in the 1940s, the rickshaw number increased to 500 to 600. But nowadays, there are 500,000 rickshaws in Dhaka. This is the first car ever in Dhaka to run, and it was owned by the Nawabs. It came in around 1900 to 1904. Actually, the Nawabs built, they have created a company to import the cars from Calcutta to bring them. And the first motor shop workshop was built in 1932, so we could understand that the roads were becoming prominent than the boat and the waterways by then. So my future scope for research and conclusion is that not much research has been done, solely focusing on the history of the transportation system and how it grew up. The city has seen many ups and downs in terms of connectivity and in terms of area. It was around 12.5 square kilometers in the Mughal period and then shrunk to less than 4 square kilometers. And the many infrastructures which we cannot find today, it used to be visible, like few roads, few bridges, few bonds for better connectivity. And there has been many types of settlements because of this kind of connectivity, and we have not yet explored the situation, how it worked as a trading post or a production center in terms of their logistics and their transportation connection networks. As Dhaka was quite famous for its muslin or some agricultural products, and as an export center. So that would be my conclusion, that there is much, much more to explore and to find out in terms of the history of transportation system and how it evolved the city of Dhaka. And thank you for the presentation.
Thank you, Dhrubo. That was exactly on time. thanks very much for that. So we have about, we can do is let's take a set of questions from the audience, and instead of like one-on-one kind of thing, if you can collect a few questions, and then the speakers can respond to that. I'd like to keep about 2 or 3 minutes in the end, so that I can kind of also sort of give a little bit of a comment back on the papers. I'm happy to leave those as open questions. If you have time, we can figure out like a response to them as well. So, just kind of opening the floor.
Juan Kinker from DePaul University, and question concerning the appropriate technology, which I'm a fan of. I support the idea, but I confront a central challenge that has three parts. First, is it compatible with capitalism? So is it going to run into a conflict with capitalism if you implement? Second is sustainability for a population globally that's going to 10 billion people. Can appropriate technology sustain 10 billion? Third, right, and somewhat connected to the second, is how do you scale up? Is it just small? Is it just local? And then how do you scale the proposal up? Thank you.
Hi. Hi, I'm Shrishti. I'm from University of Delhi, Department of Sociology. My question is to Tahera. I'm wondering that when you're saying that the dependency has been removed once the pipelines have come into play, when the pond has been then sort of linked to the community through these pipelines, but I'm also wondering that you think there are actually new modes of dependency which then develop on the pipelines, it's due to this connectivity by the community, especially with the political system which might be in play. And the second would be that this everyday, with this imagination that there is a dependency between the naturally existing water body and the community, but also that this dependency comes with a burden. And I would imagine, looking at some of the ethnography I have read in India, in rural India, of as on date, and this burden actually falls on women. So it actually becomes a form of labor which they have to perform. So would you have any comments on that?
Hello. So hi, I'm Nitin. The Geddes project on surgical urbanism, or how it was called, surgical conditioning, surgery planning. Okay, this one reminded a little bit of the Haussmannian approach in Paris, and also I think there's been some in the first decade of the 2000s, there's been some sort of like revival of this way of thinking in Latin America, like where they did a lot of such projects in Rio and Sao Paulo especially, and it resulted into very similar results as the Haussmannian project had resulted into. Like, so it led to a lot of gentrification, and people kind of, after these projects happened, people who were living there originally kind of getting out, and new people coming in who can afford such sort of technologies. So my question is around this, basically, like, have you studied, like, for example, the street that you were showing in Madras, like, was there some sort of gentrification that happened? If not, if it didn't happen, then what were the means through which they kind of were able to retain the people who were originally living there? And also, the second project that you showed, the one of Laurie Baker, where he kind of proposes something instead of the slum. So, like, how does it, in your opinion, relate to somehow empowering the slum dwellers to recreate something of their own? So, like, instead of like a neo top down kind of approach, what would you think of like something that's bottom-up, appropriate technology approach?
Okay, I will take just one more question if there is another one. And if I can request, you can keep your question a little bit shorter, because we are running out of time, so that'll be nice.
Yeah, hi, my name is Pradnya, and my question is for Dhrubo. Dhrubo, thanks for your presentation. It was really interesting, especially in the beginning where you sort of looked at how the city evolved along the river, and you sort of started the conversation between the relationship between spatial form and mobility routes. And then when you started talking about the trains and the cars, somehow those maps started disappearing. And so I just wanted to ask if you sort of saw any relationship in the change of the urban form as transit patterns evolved.
Thank you. So, maybe we can start.
Hi. Actually, like, our concept of our paper is not like, we are not trying to say that we shouldn't be developed. Like, we are not saying that we don't need development. Like, we want to keep our reality as it is. But what we are saying, like, what you have said, like, after installation of pipe water, the relationship with the pond and the people was directly removed. So what we are saying, when we are planning for urban or we are planning for development, we should keep it this mind, like how we can keep that relationship. It's still in the search process, so like we are not saying that we don't have to we put this burden again to them, but like is there, because we have found that the source of that relationship was that constraint. So we can design constraint, exactly. I hope it answers.
I think industrialization goes hand in hand, and I don't think appropriate technology was ever conceived independent of that. It felt more like from the literature I've read, and I'm still reading, but Gandhi, Schumacher, whoever you look at, they don't say it's an either or thing, but it's more of responsible capitalism, perhaps, even if that happens. And having various scales, that's one persistent question that always comes, at what scale can it work? Which is what your second question was. Which is why I feel personally, I argue that it should be a part of a bigger toolkit when you think of planning or developing a city or an economy. I do not think appropriate technology could be the only way to do something, but I feel it would work at a smaller scale, because when you can think about local governance, why not local technology? I mean, you have policies for local governance. You have 74th constitutional amendment that says people should have ward committees, etc. So maybe there should be some policy kind of approvals or legislation that kind of promotes appropriate technology more at a local scale. So scalability, perhaps, it obviously cannot solve the world's problems, but it probably helps people take more control of their living conditions at a very local level. That's what my thought is. Regarding the questions about gentrification, and so again, as I said, Geddes' projects never really took off on ground, so I'm sorry I don't have an answer for the Tanjore project. His solution broadly was to he was arguing against, and if you think about the time when he was responding to the planning projects that were going on, or the way planning was being done, it was very radical at that time too. Suggest that you do not just throw the baby out with the bathwater, which is not my own phrase, but noted conservationist A.G.K. Menon, last year was even a talk on smart cities and organic cities, and he was talking about don't throw the good with the bad, and that's primarily what Geddes is also arguing about. And the other thing is, there's always a danger of gentrification, and not just here, but any project across the world, when you think of Jane Jacobs' writings too, and neighborhoods that have been designed along those lines. People do obviously want, they become desirable places to live in. They want the high density and multi-use, multi-purpose kind of neighborhoods. So that's something that one has to kind of, it's a challenge at all times. Baker's project, again, so Baker's slum development project, I guess what's empowering is, first of all, people are not displaced. They continue to live where they do, and in the context that they've grown up in. And they also become part of the building process, and they kind of build their own spaces, in that sense taking ownership of their houses. So I guess that's where the element of empowerment comes in.
Dhrubo, can you hear us?
Yes.
Yeah, so you had one question as well. Would you like to respond to that now? We are actually officially out of session time, so a quick response would be nice.
Okay, I'm not sure if I thinking the overall, Dhaka was really very much it was water body and different terrain, and even from geomorphological map, as you can see. But for more reliability and faster mode of transportation, everyone who came, and also for the business and the trade, mostly land-based transport preference than the river for the canal. So the city used to expand along the river, all the canal, to connect the other network. It has changed from that to the, like, now, and even for like last 200 years, it started to connect the locations which are actually connected by rail or by streets or roads. And it's a situation that goes both ways, vice versa, that sometimes the production center is from the Dhaka city has been connected with roads or rail. And one interesting, I would like to finish with one interesting example that in 66 or no, maybe the 1600s, when one guy from England, William Geddes, came here and he complained about the location of the English factory 3 miles from the city and he had to go by boat. So, in the end, there was a road built in the 1800s and that was connected. But even then, the factory was moved inside the city for a better connection. And the British built a better road. So that was a shift from the water body and the water and the river and network to more fast and reliable land-based or surface-based transportation service. Thank you.
Thanks, Dhrubo. So, in the interest of time, I think I'm just going to like conclude the session, but I think for me the most useful part of the session was across all the three papers. It's sort of a little bit of a wake-up call because much of the conversation that is emerging around technology or a technology-led kind of interventions into urban development, whether we like it or not, or whether we are aware of it or not, seems to fall back into the frame of thinking about technology in terms of technological fixes. Right, and in some ways it is often coming in response to sort of a Malthusian problematization of urban growth. And I like take very well the kind of the question that came from the audience as well, that there's a very, very strong question of scale that is associated with it. And so technology is often seen as a response to the scale problem of urbanization. And I think all the three papers, what they have done today, and I think done quite well, is to sort of remind us again that technology does not necessarily always, it's not a given that technology comes with the idea of scale, and especially large scales inbuilt into them, and that there are other interpretations of technology, more evolutionary ways of seeing how urbanization has evolved, to see that technology can also play a role at smaller scales. But what that then throws up as a result, and across all the three papers, I think, is then how do we sort of bring together a more evolutionary idea of technology at smaller scales, a more relational view of technology into the kind of politics of urban development that are emerging now. So this is kind of my larger overarching questions across the three papers. So for you, Tahera, my provocation is to say that the social geographies or the constraints that have shaped the city so far and now are falling apart with new financial interventions, are there also new social geographies to these new financial interventions? And what is that conversation that is happening with the earlier language of constraint and the new language of constraint that's appearing? Because I don't think that these interventions are also, you know, neutral on the question of constraint. I think the constraint idea is coming from somewhere else. And so I think it would be really useful if your work
could, you know, sort of bridge that conversation around constraint of how it has been and how it is being interpreted now. Salila, in your case, again, I think going back to some of the questions that came from the audience, is that how does this idea of appropriate technology speak to the current politics of planning and urban development? And given that even in the city of Bangalore that we're sitting in right now, much of the 74th amendment, including the MPC question, has not, you know, seen the light of day in any effective sort of way. We have all these conversations around the master plan, etc., right now. So how does this question of appropriate technology, how can it feed into the current debates and negotiations and the terrains around the politics of planning, the contemporary politics of planning? And Dhrubo, again, in terms of your paper as well, I would ask you to sort of think about that. It's a fascinating history of, you know, how transportation modes have changed and how they have fed into the form of the city itself. But there are also sort of these new transportation interventions that are being made now. And if there, I mean, I think your paper is quite clear in sort of saying that there is definitely a disconnect. But like in the first paper, I would sort of, my thing would be to push you to think about what are the new logics that are emerging and how well or how you know, not so well or not so suitably do they speak to the form of the city that has emerged. So across the three papers, I think my provocation is to link it to the contemporary politics and then contemporary interventions, and I think then this becomes a really useful conversation to kind of keep going. The tension that you have brought out, to keep that tension going into the current conversations as well. So thank you very much, everyone. We have a tea break right now. So we have until 11:30. This next panel begins at 11:30. So I would also request that those of you who have remaining questions can catch the speakers during the break and, you know, sort of carry on the conversation. But thank you so much.
Thank you.